Charles Ramsey. I don't know if you this is the guy who the neighbor across the street who'd actually been suspended from his job and for just a weekend or something. And anyway, he was home luckily because he had just gone back from McDonald's and he heard a scream and he kicked in the door to save this young woman. And then she, to her credit, didn't just run away, but she remained and made sure that her two fellow kidnappees would also be there. Would also be saved. So to me, I guess my first question is to me, this reminds us of our collective responsibility one to another. If you hear a scream, you should do something about it. You shouldn't ignore it.
Yeah.
There was a infamous example several decades ago now in Central Park where a woman screamed she was being raped and several people heard the screams, but each one thought someone else was acting and no one came to save her.
There were actually numerous cases like that in New York City.
Okay.
Unfortunately.
One of the surveys on this issue they've done has shown that you're more likely to help someone the less populated area it is. And that's not necessarily a slight on New Yorkers so much as that people think that if other people are there, the other people will act. And to some extent, that makes some sense. I mean, if I hear someone scream and I see a crowd of 50 people around that person, I'm going to think that someone's helping that person. If I see someone scream and she or he is all alone, then I'll be there. But it's very different, of course, when you can't see and when you don't know who's there and you just make the decision not to go.
Yeah, and I think that's a key point that you make. My practice has been and that whenever there's something that is out of the norm, be it a noise, an explosion, a scream, you investigate. Whether you jump in or not is another thing, but you can't make that decision unless you investigate. So, if something goes on in my neighborhood or any neighborhood I've lived in, including New York City and Washington and all over the place, is you go out and look. You find out what is going on. You don't just sit in your home and turn the television up. You just can't do that. And unfortunately, too many people do just that.
Yeah. Although, I got to tell you, in recent years, we've been hearing more and more examples of people intervening, calling 911. I think about the Trayvon Martin case. I wish the cops had come a little bit sooner, but obviously a whole bunch of people heard screams. There was, late black night, and it was, obviously very scary for people, but they did call 911. And it just be a reminder, just if you hear something like that, obviously you don't want to misuse 911. Some people do, they ask where the nearest post office is or something stupid like that. But if you hear screams, don't hesitate. Pick up the phone, dial 911. Even if it's just people playing around, if you have any reason to believe that something, a foul play is afoot, then don't hesitate. That's what it's for.
I would go so far, and this is just, my choice, so I'm not really advocating this for other people, but I have seen I've been in a situation in Washington, D.C., as for instance, where some people were beginning to harass and beat up some young women, and I was in my car driving. And, even though there's some people in my car who were all upset, I drove straight for that crowd, put on my bright lights, laid on the horn, and made it perfectly obvious to the perpetrators that this was not going unseen. And, didn't have to go further than that because they broke up and run away.
That's interesting. Terry, I have a similar story. It happened to me when I was, I think I was a teenager. I don't think I've been driving. I remember I was in my dad's Oldsmobile Delta 88. I don't know if you remember that car.
Oh, sure.
It's basically a two-door tank. It's twice as big as any car is today, even though it only had two doors, and those doors were heavy. But it is indestructible. Yeah. I was in high school, I'm sure, because it happened in Nashville. So I must have been 17 or 18, maybe 16 years old. But I remember driving by. There's a park where I'm from, Nashville, Tennessee. I was driving by the park, and I heard a woman scream. And I heard the scream. So I drove into the park, and I saw a woman running. And she ran toward the car, and there was some guy chasing her, and I didn't know the circumstance, I didn't know the details, but I knew enough that I actually took my big tank, my car, and I did sort of what you did, Terry. I turned the lights on, and I sort of drove toward him. I obviously wasn't going to hit him, but he didn't know that, and basically separated the two of them with my car. You know, later on, people told me, Mark, that was really dangerous. He could have had a gun, you know, and I don't know. I guess I felt indestructible in that car. But and then he took off, and she actually, and again, I don't normally advocate picking up hitchhikers, but in this circumstance, she knocked on my window. I let her in. I said, is there someplace I can take you? She told me an address, and I took her there.
That's an interesting point, too, because the same thing happened to me in this situation I was describing. The people in the car said, you know, don't do it, don't do it. You know, what if they got a gun? We'll get shot, we'll get a shot. You know, and I said, which in some ways, you know, I'm not sure it was the right thing to do because it endangered other people's lives in my car. But I said, you know, I can't do nothing just because of that possibility. You know, and I'm not trying to say that I'm super courageous. I'm not. I just sort of believe in acting and taking steps.
You know, I was partly inspired. And again, I don't know if that was the smartest thing to do. A lot of people in Nashville have a gun. Though, like I said, I think if someone had shot at me, I might have peeled off. But I think I was inspired a little bit by my mother. This is a great story for Mother's Day, something I just thought about. I hadn't thought about in a long time. She was driving me home from school one day, and I don't think I could have been more than 9 or 10. And she saw a guy on a motorcycle, and like, I don't know whether a car almost hit him or whatever, he was taking evasive action, but whatever it is, he spun out, his motorcycle lay on his side, and he laid in sort of a bleeding hump near a bridge. And my mom immediately, without question, stopped by the road. We helped that man into the car, and we drove him to the hospital. And, you know, I at the time, you know, you're 9, you're 10, you don't really question it. Later on, you know, you're thinking, I mean, this was some strange young man. It was, you know, a young mother and a little boy. And but I mean, clearly, again, because I, you know, my mom told me, you know, don't pick up hitchhikers. This was not a hitchhiker.
Yeah, right.
Obviously, this was a guy who just suffered an accident. You know, in hindsight, maybe we should call an ambulance. You know, I don't know. Maybe we did it wrong. But the idea was not necessarily what we did or what she did, because I was just following along. But just the idea that you see someone in need, you go and you help out.
You act, and
there are all kinds of, it's funny, you know, you look at a guy like Charles Ramsey, who was here in these studios at We Act Radio AM 1480 just yesterday, and this is a guy, he's a dishwasher, he's having hard times, he's having a hard time. He's living literally paycheck to paycheck, waiting for his paycheck to come in, wondering if he can afford enough to pay for a Big Mac. People, I think there's certain middle class people, white people, shall we say, Republicans. I don't know. I don't want to stereotype anyone else, but I think there are those that might look on a guy like Chuck Ramsey and see him as just, not your model citizen, put it that way. And I think just because he's poor and he's black and he's certainly colorful. I'm going to actually be playing some of his interviews later on in the Inside Scoop. If you want to stick around to hear that, that'll be at 1 o'clock. I'll be playing comment on those interviews. But what I think it shows is that stereotypes are can be misleading. And I think one of the funniest lines he made, and one that's actually been made a remix on YouTube, is when he said, when it was a dead giveaway that something's wrong when a little white girl runs into a black man's arms. He was joking about it, but his point is that there are people that would overlook a guy like Charles Ramsey. But Charles Ramsey didn't overlook trouble when he saw it, and he went in like any decent human being would do, and went to save a life.
You know, one of the beautiful things, Mark, about my own experience, and I don't want to get into it, but you know, I've had problems in the past, which I've talked about openly before, and which required me to get into some 12-step programs. And the first thing you learn, and you learn it very quickly, is you really can't judge anybody. And the guy sitting next to you who has nothing in common with you may say the most important thing to you at that moment that you've heard in a lifetime. And you simply cannot choose or judge who has what capabilities or what thoughts or what emotions. It's a privilege for me to be in a kind of program like that and to discover the incredible emotional, spiritual, and mental unity of people. And it's you simply don't know. You can't look down at anybody. It's just foolish. It's just plain foolish to do so, you know.
Well, one of the things that I want to ask about this case is some what if questions, because at the same time we've just finished a debate on gun control and background checks. And the thing that everyone seemed to agree on, obviously 90% of Americans want background checks. Most of us don't want these semi-automatic weapons on the street. But the thing that even liberals concede is that, you know, if a guy comes to your home, you can basically mow him down with a gun. And one of the things that struck me is the risk that Charles Ramsey took when he kicked this guy's door in. Right. I mean, he heard a cry for help, and I think that would be justified. In fact, I know it would be according to the law. But at the same time, I sort of imagined, Castro, apparently one of the things he used to do, and this is from his now deceased ex. I don't think he was ever married to her, but the woman that he lived with for a couple decades, who talked about how he brutally abused her and beat her, and he would do things like put her in a cardboard box and threaten her that she couldn't come out until he said so, and really, really sadistic things. But one of the things that he would do is he'd pretend to leave the home, and then if he heard her calling someone and complaining about him or something, then he'd beat her up. One of the things that, of course, Castro could have done was leave the home. And then if a guy comes and kicks in your door, I could just see him shooting the guy, you know, this unemployed, or not unemployed, but suspended dishwasher, and say, hey, you know, this black guy kicked in my door, so I shot him dead. And I wonder, you know, of course, I don't know if the girls would ever have been found then. Maybe not. But I just wonder whether people would have given a guy the benefit of the doubt. I mean, after all, he could have heard a scream, and it might not have been young kidnapped girls. It could have been just a young girl playing around, right? You know, I mean, 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds have been known to scream. It wasn't. This was a young adult. But it just strikes me that if you do see something and you say something and you go and you check it out, somebody with an itchy trigger finger might, you could be totally innocent and you should go and check these things out. And yet our society is defending itchy trigger finger guy.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, it's a question. It's a decision you have to make in advance. You know, are you going to live in a state of fear or aren't you? You know, and I'm not saying it's easy, and I'm not saying that can't get scared the crap out of me just the same as anybody else. But, you know, if you suspect something is wrong, of course there's a risk. Of course there's a risk, you know. But you have to accept that risk. You have to make that decision ahead of time. You can't make it when it happens. You know, it's too late. So, you know, I've sort of dedicated myself to that. And yeah, maybe, and I'm not pretending I'm courageous. I'm not in any sense courageous. But you do act. You can knock on the door. You can call the police. You can do something. You know, and if you get shot, you know, God forfend, that's part of the risk, but you can't ignore it. The sad thing to me about this whole story, besides the tragedy to the women itself, is how in hell in any neighborhood, I don't care if there's only 5 people living in the neighborhood, can something go on for 10 years and nobody knows anything?
Well, a part of the reason, I think, has to do with a number of things. One, according to the news accounts, there was a distrust between the people in this fairly poverty-stricken neighborhood and the police. The residents didn't trust the police didn't trust the residents. And so a number of people would just sort of keep quiet, protecting each other. And there's a whole lot of things that go into this in my mind. One is, you know, we have a drug culture where I'm not, you know, I will turn in my neighbor if he's kidnapping or raping girls, for sure, but I'm not going to turn to my neighbor if he's smoking pot. You know, right. It's illegal in Virginia. I don't care. Doesn't bother me any. That is the law, and I'm not required to turn him in. You're not. And so I just leave him alone. So I think in a culture where policemen are responding to far lesser things that I don't even think should be criminal, then people are less likely to have this relationship with the police when things are serious. And one of the things we do seem to know, and they're investigating more, is the police were called to this house several times. and they never went inside. And they there was one where a young girl was seen in a dog collar on all fours, naked. At least the residents say they called the police. The police say they have no record of that. But this is an issue where the police need to get involved. They can't just let these things go.
Well, you bring up another real important thing. In certain neighborhoods, the police ignore what's going on. When I lived in Houston, Texas, and this was quite a while ago, when I lived in Houston, Texas, I knew a police reporter who reported on all the crimes that happened in Houston, Texas. This was, I hate to say how long ago, but it was in the 70s. And
back when you were only 103.
Yeah, only 103.
Okay.
Barely able to walk, but 103.
Right.
And, he literally told me that he never reported any crimes committed against blacks because the police at that time never even recorded any crimes committed against black, murder, rape, anything.
Who told you this?
This reporter for the Houston Chronicle.
The reporter didn't put any of those in the newspaper because the police didn't respond.
Never recorded them.
They didn't record them.
No.
So apparently there were no black victims in Houston throughout the 1970s.
Nope.
At least according to recorded documentation.
I mean, this is the same city, you got to remember, at the same time that I was there, that the Ku Klux Klan blew up Pacifica's transmitters twice in 1 year.
Yeah, special place, Houston.
But there is that attitude in police departments, and I wouldn't be surprised in any urban police department there are those cops who, because there's problems in certain impoverished neighborhoods, they'd rather just ignore it. And, the strange thing is, and this goes way back, when I was a young man, there was a philosophy that was talked about all the time, which, believe it or not, and it wouldn't work in today's society because today's society is out of whack as far as I'm concerned, but it was called citizen's arrest. And you literally had the legal, and still have, the legal right to arrest people in certain circumstances.
Yeah, I wouldn't trust a lot of citizens with that right.
But
you're absolutely right.
Today.
I mean, let me give you an example. I didn't quite do citizen's arrest, but I was just thinking about examples where I helped someone in distress. This one occurred outside my house in Alexandria about 6 or 7 years ago. I heard a woman scream, "Give me back my wallet." And it was weird because I live in a decent neighborhood and it's not I'm not like on a street corner. I imagine pickpockets sort of work on busy streets, and this is not. This is like near a park. But anyway, I heard it and I was close to my door and I looked outside to see what was going on. And it was a weird thing because it wasn't a guy running. There was a guy there and he had what looked like a woman's purse in his hand, and this woman was like, "Give me back my wallet." And it was weird. I would think someone who grabbed a wallet would, I thought I was going to be in a chase, actually. And I looked at the guy and I looked at her and I said to the guy, do you have this woman's wallet?
How nice of you. How polite.
and I mean, it's surreal now that I think about it. Yeah. And he's like, "It's none of your business." And I took that as a yes. I actually ran inside to get my cell phone, which I knew right where it was, and ran back out. They were still there. And she's like, "Give me my wallet." And I said, "Sir, give her back her wallet or I'm going to call 911. And he's like, "Stay out of it." And I'm like, "Well, I'm in it now. So, give her back her wallet in 10 seconds or I'm calling 911. So he throws her wallet back at her, but they stay there. And I start to recognize, okay, this isn't your ordinary pickpocket.
Yeah,
these
we got
two
a domestic problem.
Exactly.
There.
These two know each other. So she has her car parked. I have a place to park near my place that's not too far away. It's a 1 minute walk. It's that close. And she said, "Would you mind walking me to my car?" To me, and I said, "Sure, I'll walk you to your car." So I walk her to her car, and this guy follows.
Oh, good.
On foot. And she starts to get in the car, and he blocks the door. And he won't let her leave. And again, now I'm learning it is a domestic dispute. I guess she's breaking up with him. He wants her not to. But again, I know he can't keep her from leaving, whatever their dispute is. And I'm like, "Sir, you're going to let her leave, or I'm going to call 911. And he's like, you know, I told you to stay out of it. And again, it's daylight. So, you know, he doesn't have any weapon. He's a little bit larger than me, but I feel like I'm okay. I mean, I don't feel like he's going to beat me to a pulp or anything. I mean, I felt like I could take him if I needed to, or at least give him back some. But I'm like thinking of all these things are in my mind. And I'm like, you know, again, if you don't let her leave in 10 seconds, look, you could just walk away and you're done. But if you don't let her leave in the next 10 seconds, I'm going to call 911. And I literally do a countdown, 10, 9, 8, and at 0, I call 911. That's why I got my phone. I said, explain to 911 what's happening. I do it right in front of him, and they send a cop, and he's still there. And he doesn't go. He doesn't attack me. He doesn't go away. He doesn't let her leave. And the cop comes and's like, you know, and I explain to the police officer, this guy won't let this woman leave. And the guy says the cop says to the guy, come with me. The guy still doesn't want to leave the side of the car, but the cop is like, no, sir, you have to come with me. And of course he pulls the guy away and she gets to leave in her car. But I don't know. For me, it was sort of a surreal incident, but again, yeah, I felt like I had to do something, and that's what I chose to do. I don't know if it was the right way to do it, but, I don't know.
It makes a difference. It makes a difference because, you know, what you're showing, you know, again, you know, I don't, I've learned also that it simply has to do with, I don't know, one's makeup. I have been, unfortunately, in a few fires of buildings.
Really?
That have caught on fire. Yeah,
wow.
I've been in four fires.
Four
and
fires?
I'm not an arsonist.
Terry, I have never been in a single fire in my life.
Well, hang
four
on with me a little more.
Fires? Four? Yeah. Okay, yeah. One, that's an accident. Two, that's yeah, an unlikely set of circumstances. Three, that's incredibly coincidental. Once you get to four, Terry, you really have to wonder.
Yeah.
But go
yeah,
ahead.
I do, believe
four,
me. I
four
do.
Fires.
Two of them were not that serious. One of them was horrible.
Wow.
But anyway.
I've seen a fire. I've never been in a fire.
I was in a theater, and a couple of women actually burned beyond recognition.
Oh, my God.
It was horrible. But wow. The point I'm making is some people act, and some people flee. And there's not a right or wrong to that either. I mean, and I cannot explain, as I'm sure you can't explain, why in some cases I just act rather than run. Now, it may be a lot smarter to run, and there's been a few situations where I have run, you know, but
I think the difference is if you can save someone else, I think it's your moral responsibility to act.
I
mean, if a guy's chasing me and it's just me and the guy, I'm going to run.
Yeah.
But if there's someone in distress, I don't know. I feel like that's sort of part of who we are as human beings. We can't.
It's part also of what our makeup is. And again, the point I'm trying to make is like, in the fire in the theater, there were 300 people there, and you know, 300 people basically panicked. And if it were for this happened with a drink being served, a flaming drink, and the bottle exploded.
Oh my God!
Oh yeah, it was horrible.
How can you serve a flaming drink in a crowded place? Well, I guess you can. I guess there are restaurants that do it.
You can do anything you want. Yeah,
I guess so. I never thought about
it. Texas, what
right? Right, land of no regulation.
Yeah, right. You know, and the bottle exploded.
Right.
And these two waitresses were instantly on fire.
Oh, my
and,
God.
Myself and a cop, who didn't know he was a cop at the time, he was just a member of the audience, and the bartender were the only people that reacted. You know, and I grabbed a fire extinguisher and ran in there, and the bartender left over the bar to try to get to him, and the cop really saved the day at all because he pulled down a curtain.
Yeah,
and
smothered them.
Over,
yeah, that's what I was thinking.
To the women.
Right.
You know, and... You know, so we took control of the situation and calmed the audience down and everything else, literally by grabbing a microphone and after we'd got the girls out of there and telling the audience, sit down, you know, that we have it under control, which was sort of a myth. We didn't really, because the cop had lost his gun in the smoldering grape.
Oh, my God.
So he and I are crawling around in the air trying to find his gun.
Oh, my God.
You know? But,
yeah, you wouldn't want someone else to find that.
But I've also learned just in theatrical situations where equipment has broken and things, you know, a drop has fallen or something like that. Some of us just act and some don't. And that's not making anybody else stronger or weaker than anybody else. Although with the one exception that I think we've talked about, you sort of make the decision ahead of time, like we're talking about, that I will do something.
Well, and I hope people listening to us, because you never know where heroes are going to come from. And I hope if you're listening in your car driving around on this beautiful Sunday day or at home or wherever you are listening on the web or the podcast, that you think about what you would do in a difficult situation. And sometimes heroics are, you know, really hard for people to do. That my favorite hero, as it were, the guy I always mention when I think about things like this, is a certain Lenny Skutnik, a federal worker who in 1982 saw Air Florida land on the collapse, go through the 14th Street Bridge, and land in the icy Potomac. Back that was before global warming, folks. 30 years ago, it really was cold in the Washington winter, and there's icebergs. Literally, I mean, there's ice floating in the river. Yeah. There's people that are drowning, and this guy, this really kind of unassuming looking federal worker, throws off his shoes and jumps in the water. They have a helicopter, and it's leading, and he's getting people to the helicopter, and every time they tried to sort of save him, he would grab another victim and put him or her there so they could be saved. Of course, he was actually the first ordinary citizen recognized by the President of the United States, at that time President Ronald Reagan, in his State of the Union address, and that's actually where the tradition started that continues to this day. But again, Lenny Skutnik, he's got this great everyman name. You know, I think of sort of Death of a Salesman, just this ordinary guy who... And the funny thing about Lenny Skutnik is he never wanted publicity. He was kind of embarrassed by all the attention surrounding what he'd done. He made it seem like everyone would have done such a thing. And you like to think you would have, but jumping into icy water on a winter's day when you could freeze to death?
That would slow me down.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm not a good swimmer to begin with.
I'm a decent swimmer, but I don't like cold water to begin with.
No.
I'm fine in the summer. But, if the water's 60 degrees, I don't want to go in. And when it's, 30 degrees, I just don't know if I would. I like to think I would have had the courage to do that. I think we all would like to think that, but I wonder.
To a large degree, what I've observed and learned is it's instinctual. I mean, yes, you make the decision ahead of time, but that doesn't mean you'll do it every time. It's instinctual. And you see an opportunity where you can do something and you go in to do it. If you don't see that opportunity to do something, you may not go into it.
And obviously you have to recognize your limitations.
Yeah.
I mean, if a guy's holding a girl at gunpoint, it would be foolhardy, unless you're really good, to try to knock the gun out of his hands, because you might just end up getting her shot.
I've seen all these movies. All I have to do is jump in the air and kick him in the head, right?
Right, and best to do it in slow motion.
Yeah,
because that way the cameras get it, and the grin, and then the agony of the guy getting hurt, and it's also good if music is playing while
it
happens.
Ask
Quentin Tarantino.
And if I make some really smart aleck quip as I'm flying through the air.
Yes, that's the appropriate. Well, at least we know the appropriate way to do it.
Right.
All right, listen, we're going to take a break. But when we come back, I know that, Terry, you want to talk about sort of the cultural aspects of all of this. And also want to encourage people to call in if you wish at 202-889-9797. 202-889-9797. We'll be right back with the Raucous Caucus right after this.
You're listening to WPWC We Act Radio, 1480 AM, weactradio.com.
Hello, my name is Jim Gray, and I am a judge of the Superior Court in California and a former federal prosecutor in Los Angeles. I would like to talk to you for a moment about marijuana. Did you know that since the federal government first banned marijuana in 1937, usage in this country has actually gone up by about 4,000%? Or did you know that in the Netherlands, where adults are allowed to possess small amounts of marijuana and buy it from government-regulated businesses, fewer adults and fewer teenagers smoke marijuana than here in our country? Or that an American is arrested on marijuana charges every 38 seconds? If you are wondering if any of this makes sense, you are not alone. To find out more, contact the Marijuana Policy Project at 1-877-JOIN-MPP or visit them on the web at mpp.org. Thank you and good luck to us all.
You're listening to WPWC We Act Radio, 1480 AM, weactradio.com.
Welcome back to the Raucous Caucus. If you don't know about what happened in Cleveland, where have you been? Every single news media in the country, not just CNN, MSNBC, and Fox, of course, all the local media, local newspapers, Huffington Post, it's been tweeted about. We're going to play, when we begin the Inside Scoop, actually a remix of Charles Ramsey talking about saving the girl, and it turned out to be girls, and they put it to an auto-tune, which is hilarious, and I'll be playing that. But clearly, this has been a cultural phenomenon, and Terry, you wanted to talk about that.
I did indeed, Mike, and this really sort of fits with the whole thing, you know, and I mean, first off, I just, a little background. I've been in theater my entire life, and part of the job in theater, and I've also been, you know, hired and worked as a historian and actually perform as historic reenactor, et cetera, et cetera. But being in theater, what you do is you spend your whole darn life studying culture, history, context, and why people do the things they do. I mean, that's what it's about. You have to figure that out before you direct a play. You know, why do the people do what they're doing? Anyway, culture obviously mirrors society, or society mirrors culture, in either direction one leads or follows the other. It doesn't make any difference which one comes first. But our culture sucks, to put it bluntly.
Is that the technical, cultural, sociological term for that?
It's an academic term.
Okay, all right. I'll have to look it up.
Yeah, right. Our culture sucks.
Our culture sucks.
Yes, and it truly does. And it's, you know,
how profoundly put.
Thank you. Thank you.
You must have worked really hard at that. Never mind. Go ahead. Why does our culture suck?
Well, it's reflected, obviously, in TVs and television and our politics and in marketing more than anything else. But there's three main destructive patterns and trends within our culture that are driving our society to the brink, and I mean to the brink. One is exceptionalism. Two is individualism. Three is violence. You know, now there was a time when exceptionalism, individualism had some kind of a positive side, but that's long gone.
There's nothing wrong with being exceptional.
It's impossible to begin with. None of us are unique. Some of us achieve some things pretty good. Other things we are terrible at. Can't yield a hammer. Can't write a poem. You know, there's nobody that's exceptional, meaning that they are different or above anybody else. But what this leads to, let me give you an example of the exceptionalism. Here I'm talking in terms of our history. PBS is doing this fluff piece, I'm sorry to say, because I really was a fan of Peter Sagal's until I watched this. PBS, yes, doing this piece with Peter Sagal running around in his beautiful Harley talking about the Constitution, supposedly, right? And he goes to Yale. Now, this is throughout our society. He goes to Yale, and he talks to a professor who I would call a fool, but he calls himself a professor.
Do you know you're attacking my alma mater here? I don't know if you knew that.
I have many things to say about your alma mater, but
Go ahead. Yeah, I can take it.
Okay. But anyway, this professor is professing that the founding of America was the historical Big Bang, never done before, totally unique, magnificent, etc., the birth of all civilization. You know, well, BS. I mean, it's absolutely nonsense for any academic to say this. You know, America's founding as a representative democracy is just an evolutionary process. There was Greece, there was Rome, there was the Magna Carta, there's the unwritten British Constitution, on which a lot of our Constitution is based. And, of course, there's Martin Luther, even before that time. All of these things.
And some pretty democratic principles in the Hebrew Bible, I must say.
Yeah, going all the way back. I mean, it's an evolutionary process that we just happened to codify, which is nice. We codified it. That's great. You know, but it wasn't all that new. It truly wasn't. The second part of the exceptionalism in our country that's absolutely absurd, believing that somehow that this Constitution and our creation of this nation, which again was a process and it involved good things and bad things like slavery, is that the nonsense that founding, that the job was so well done that we don't have to do any more. That we're done. We finished it. We have our Constitution and we're done. And that's obviously nonsense. You know, it's anti-evolution. It's anti-reason. It's anti-science. Scalia is an idiot. Pardon my strong approach.
Can I stop you before you go on? Because yeah. I agree with half of what you're saying.
Only half.
I certainly agree Scalia is an idiot, but that's a side point. No, he's actually not an idiot. He's actually a very smart and evil person.
Unfortunately, yes.
So it's not about, I mean, he's very purposely doing what he does. So I agree with you. with the latter part of what you said, that obviously we're not perfect. Even our founders said we want to form a more perfect union, which obviously the idea is that each generation would try to perfect it more. Obviously, we've come a long way. Slavery's gone. Women can vote now. We're on the verge of even...
We use immigrant labor for labor.
Well, that's true.
And prisons.
True as well. Again, my point is, we do have a way to go. I'm not, but at the same time, I'm going to agree with part of what that Yale professor said, which is, I do think it was an exceptional moment in history. America's founding, it was not unique. I think exceptional and unique are two different words. I'm not claiming uniqueness, but part of my fear, I think that any moment in history, it's never black and white, it's gray.
No.
And I think that sometimes while conservatives are too loath to mention all the real and systemic and dangerous and horrible problems that exist in America today, I think progressives sometimes are only talking about the problems and not about the progress, ironically. I guess because they want to move further, they want to progress it further.
Sure.
And
sure.
So I'm willing to accept both that America was exceptional and was a strong moment in history, and that we have improved a lot since then and we have a long way to go. So I just don't want to completely be like, you know, it was not an important moment in history.
I'm not saying it's not important at all, but I am saying it's evolutionary. It's part of a historical process that is evolving for centuries.
Okay.
And we're part of that process. So anything that we achieve may at any given moment be important or significant, maybe even exceptional, but it doesn't come out of our necessarily singular brilliance. It comes out of a process that has been evolving for decades. Second thing is this individualism. And commercials are our culture today. That is our culture to a large degree. It's really where all the money is put, which tells you how important commercials are. There's a new commercial I just saw that sort of takes it to the extreme, but it really has this idea with individualism, which is what's behind gun rights and all that crap as well. The current commercial is a guy using an electric razor. I forget which brand. I wish I remembered it because I would condemn them. But he's using an electric razor and he's shaving his body hair. You know, his chest, his arms, et cetera, et cetera. It's really kind of unpleasant. And he's admiring himself, of course, while he's shaving. And he literally says at the end of the
commercial. I do me. I've seen that commercial. Is that the one?
The one that what?
That ends with I do me?
Mm-hmm.
I saw that commercial.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Basically, you know, that he is so magnificent that he should do himself. You know, I mean, this is individualism gone to the nth degree. Then there's this other character, you know, this ridiculous thing of this one whiskey ad where these, you know, five or six men, you know, all uber macho, you know, and supposedly are exceptional and gather around the table so they can exceptionally drink booze and get exceptionally drunk, I guess, you know. But it's this exceptionalism, not exceptional, but individualism that, again, is destroying our sense of community. And finally, you know, the violence issue. We have gotten so violent in so many ways. We're about 5 minutes away from, you know, restoring the Coliseum, which will probably be done in Texas. And, you know, we've got every other commercial now has violence. Even Toyota is using violence in its commercials right now to sell their cars. Of course, the Dodge Ram is all about intimidation people. You know, violence. We have in the country now, I don't know if you've seen this, Mark, or seen signs for it. I haven't gone one, and I won't. But cage fighting, have you seen signs and advertisements?
I think I've vaguely seen something.
Yeah, they have it.
It's sort of like a fight
well.
To the death kind of thing, right?
Yeah,
sort of.
In cages. You're locked in the cage until, you know, one guy is beaten to a bloody pulp and can't fight back.
Not sure why this is legal, but I guess if boxing is legal, why shouldn't this be, right?
Well, it's way beyond boxing. There are rules. There's also a new sport along the same line called extreme rules fighting, which means there are no rules.
Right.
I mean, this is not a healthy society, and these things are attended by thousands of people. You know, obviously there's football, which is a very violent game. I enjoy watching the game myself. I enjoy the artistry in the midst of that violence, but it is a very violent game.
But you know, how is this anything new or different? I mean, the Romans famously watched in the Colosseum people would be mauled to death by lions. And other animals, or they'd kill each other, the gladiators, fight to the death while people cheered. as people were dying.
Well,
so
let me just give you a perspective on how it has changed. I lived, hundreds of years ago.
Right, you remember that Colosseum and the gladiators.
I remember the Colosseum.
Right.
Yes.
You
yes,
must
yes.
have been a kid at that time.
Oh, yeah, just a kid. Yeah, I was one of the vendors. I sold popcorn at the Colosseum. Yeah. Did you know that the vomitoriums in the reason they're called vomitoriums in the Colosseum? Are you aware?
I assume because people would binge afterwards.
Yeah. Well, not just binge, but even because of the violence, they just go into vomitoriums and throw up.
Oh, the violence would cause them to throw up.
Yeah, or the binging, whatever, but that's where.
Oh, see,
up.
I thought there was some anorexic Romans, but I must have missed that part of.
There were two. I knew them personally.
You didn't know that bulimia was the scourge of the Roman Empire, did you? All right, go ahead.
But, I grew up in a totally different era with its problems, to be sure. But for one thing, not everybody felt they had to have a gun. That just even wasn't talked about. I mean, it's just simply, you did or you didn't. Nobody really gave a damn one way or the other. I don't know if the NRA had, even awoken by that point, Secondly, the national sports time, the national pastime in sports was baseball. I mean, it really was. I mean, this is a huge cultural shift from baseball to football and now to every other sport getting as violent as it possibly can, including basketball now, where you get thrown out of the games and playoffs because you're violent, and...
And I understand that in hockey, sometimes in between the fights, a game will break out.
Oh, yeah. Exactly. But if you look at, all you have to do is watch any cable channel and the advertisements for the movies. I went to see a movie this weekend, The Great Gatsby. I recommend don't going. It's boring.
Oh, is it? Okay. I was going to see that one.
I'm a Baz Luhrmann fan. I love Baz Luhrmann, but it doesn't work in my opinion.
Okay.
Anyway. The commercial.
We do movie reviews on the Raucous Caucus. You didn't know that.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Go ahead.
I mean, there's a commercial. You've seen some of these National Guard
commercials. Rest in peace, Roger Ebert. Go ahead.
Yeah. National Guard commercials are incredibly violent, and they now have one. This is exceptionalism, individualism, and violence all tied together. They are literally in the commercial, with tons of music and effects and everything else, and showing how wonderful and heroic they are. They are equating the National Guard soldier with Superman. To the point of a cape, to the point of flying faster than a speeding bullet, so that your goal as an exceptional, violent individual is to become Superman. And all you got to do is join the National Guard or the Army, and you are Superman. And that's sort of fun, except it's really kind of shocking when you first see it, but the violence in the films and the commercials, more than anything else. I mean, violence is what sells. Commercials, films are strictly created today for the most part from an audience of 18 to about 24 is the age range that they're going for. They attend the theaters the most. They are the most violent group. They are the group involved in a lot of our mass violence. They are the group that goes to these incredibly violent movies. Thank you, Bruce Willis, another man that should be banned.
You mentioned individualism. Of course, one of the stupidest military commercials I've ever seen is the one that talked about an army of one.
Yeah.
This idea that suddenly there was going to be a one-person army that was, you go in and mow them down Rocky style. Rambo style, I should say. Rambo style.
Yeah, not Rocky style.
Rocky hit them with the fist. Rambo had the... Exactly. Anyway, that's just false. I mean, the military requires hundreds of thousands, millions actually, of men and women working together in every single aspect, from not just combat, but logistics and everything on the field, and to the veterans' healthcare. Literally millions of the Army and the Navy, Air Force, Marines could not function without a large group of dedicated people working together. Army of One was actually not just offensive culturally, it was false.
Yeah, false. And it brings up an interesting cultural point, because in the way back in time, with John Wayne and all that, but it's sort of where it started. You had this culture created from the very beginning that there's one man by himself, could save the whole city, be it, John Wayne or whomever. Have gun, will travel. You walk into a town, you got the gun, you win situation. But those were always done on, quote, the side of the good. And it was always done with sort of the violence being the very last thing that happened. Now,
don't you know the only way to stop a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun?
Well, the idiots who grew up watching,
according to Wayne LaPierre of the National Rifle Association.
Yeah, I mean, he obviously saw far too many, have gun, will travel movies.
I suppose.
Or television programs, and he really believes that. And, you know, but now we've gone way beyond that exceptionalism, individualism thing. So it is now uber violence, which is what wins the war, again, by one person. It's insanity, and this is having a huge cultural effect. You cannot separate culture from our behavior.
So let me ask you this. We began this discussion with, I guess, my topic, talking about domestic violence and when you go in to help someone and a poor neighborhood in Cleveland. Do you seem to think that our culture is either affected by or affects this? Tell me how this relates to our culture.
In Cleveland?
Yeah.
Well, I can tell you, yeah, I think it does, because what... The most single-watched thing, as you know, on the Internet is pornography.
Yeah.
That is the single most watched thing. And
I don't think the Internet would have existed without pornography.
Two
things created the Internet, Al Gore and porn.
Yeah. I'm sure we don't want to bring that up to Al. But anyway, you know, yeah. And porn, you know, began at a certain level, and it has increased again to becoming extremely violent in pornography these days. I mean, essentially gang rape is very common. Of course, they don't call it rape because supposedly the woman, you know, is all lovingly involved and really wants this to happen to her. So there is this whole...
Not so sure about that, but go ahead. Yeah.
But, I mean, it's incredibly violent, and I can't go into details on the radio, and I won't, and you know, anybody does dials it can look.
Or you could tell us why you've seen this violent pornography. It was for research purposes, right?
Of course.
The same reason the Supreme Court watches it to determine what's obscene. Did you know, by the way, they have a dirty movie theater at the Supreme Court? Did
I
you know that?
For a moment.
They do.
Would.
They have a movie theater to watch dirty movies so they can determine if something's obscene or not.
Good for them. I hope they're having a good time.
Yeah, they also have a basketball court there, by the way.
Yeah.
They do. It's called the highest court in the land. I'm not making this up.
No, I know. And I have rented the Supreme Court. Never forget that.
Well, they are for sale. I know Scalia is for sale.
No, you can rent the whole chambers and everything else.
You can also rent Scalia, apparently,
Anyway. But, you know, what the pornography, particularly the violent pornography, projects is that this behavior is essentially acceptable. That's the point of it. Though, I mean, the point is, of course, obviously, to get somebody aroused and all that, but, and you know, therefore addicted to it or whatever term you want to use. But the point is that it shows something that seems to be acceptable.
So are you blaming our culture for the likes of this monster in Cleveland?
My point is, and I know this, I absolutely know this, you can't separate culture from who we are, what we believe, and how we act. You cannot separate them. It is part of it. Whether the culture mirrors society or society mirrors the culture, it's both directions. They support each other. And if they're supporting each other in a truly negative pattern, which is what I'm saying is happening, we're in a really bad situation.
But see, I think this kind of brutality, some guy raping and abusing young girls, I think it's as old as humanity. God knows I'm not justifying it. I think it's horrific, but I don't know that this is some 21st century phenomenon.
It's the same thing as guns. If you increase the acceptability and the acceptability of anything, then, of course, it's going to become used more. And that's just a general pattern. And it is now acceptable. Whereas before, you know, way back when I was a little tiny kid, you know, if you wanted pornography, you really had to go search. I mean, you had to do some work, you know? You know, you really did.
But people did, right? I mean, you could go anywhere, even the Victorian age, right? Lady Chatterley's Lover. People had little secret things.
But even that, you see, that's essentially private.
But see, I want to make a distinction here, and I want to make the distinction between sex and violence, because all too often the two are thrown together. There's too much sex and violence in our culture. There's too much sex and violence on TV. There's too much da 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 da. And I want to make a distinction because I find it incredible that on our TV, movie theaters is different. You know, you have to be R and so forth. But on our television screen, you cannot watch naked people, right? That would be absolutely forbidden on television. But you can watch depictions of extraordinary violence. So an 8-year-old can't watch the top half of a woman because, well, that's sexual and that's wrong. And you know, we can't show breasts on the air. But he or she can watch a brutal rape and murder depicted. Okay, a rape wouldn't be shown graphically. And I just wonder about that because
almost
I you know... I don't really have a problem with sex. I mean, we could argue that this particular depiction is good or bad or pornographic or whatever. But I find it amazing that we ban lovemaking, but we show hate making on television. And I don't know. I make that distinction.
No, that's a good distinction. That's a very good distinction. And yes, I mean, the real question is the violence.
See, so I make a distinction between pornography and violent pornography.
Yes.
Yes. Pornography, I think, is as old as, cavemen, I'm sure, have pornographic pictures on caves 35,000 years ago.
It wasn't, you know, you had to still get into the cave is the difference. They, you know, you did. And if you didn't,
and I'm sure
Charlie,
the cavemen I just want to make a distinction here because I think, and maybe you think I'm wrong, I think pornography is non-violent pornography, I think, is basically harmless.
Unless,
but I don't feel the same way about violent pornography.
I suspect if you asked about if you were to show a large percentage of the pornography that is out there to strictly a female audience,
I'm sure they'd hate it. But
there's a lot. Yeah, there would be a high percentage that say this is wrong. You know.
For sexual purposes. It's certainly not, I'm not going to call it glorified art, and I'm not going to say it's Shakespeare, and, we can defend it critically. But when it comes to banning something, I want to
I'm not in favor of banning something, but unless what we're talking about today, something, Mark, is something that people don't talk about, which is our culture. What is the flavor of our culture? What is the impression? What is the message? You know, who is determining what that message is? Because you cannot separate it from our actions. It is part of it. So to some degree, poor old Castro, the crazy guy that he may have been or whatever, or pervert, whatever you want, he goes home, you know, the day of, you know, he's going home to his family, he's telling his mother that he loves him, he's having dinner with him and everything else. Somewhere in his mind, he absolutely believes what he's doing is perfectly fine. That doesn't mean that he's not nuts. I'm not saying
really?
That.
You yes. think he thought what he was doing was fine?
Well, one of the things I learned in directing is you can never get a good actor to perform any role thinking they are evil. And they are absolutely right. Whether it's Hitler, whether it's, you know, Julius Caesar, Brutus, whomever it is, there is nobody with Richard III, nobody thinks they are evil or doing something wrong when they're doing something horrendous. They just
don't. It's just so hard to imagine that he could actually. You know, it's interesting. They actually, this guy, this monster, and I said his name a couple times, but I try not to talk about the monster and talk more about the victims. Mm-hmm. But this guy, apparently, they had a march for this missing girl, Gina de Jesus, and he joined the march.
Yeah.
I don't know what. Of course, I guess the Boston bomber also, talked about how horrible the bombing was. So, but this kind of disconnect, though. I mean, they got to know.
Yeah, but this is a big mistake that we make, is saying that that person is evil. Therefore, it doesn't involve me. It doesn't involve how I think. It doesn't involve how I react. That person is crazy. So therefore, it doesn't involve me.
Well, let's say this. I am sure there are lots of middle-aged men that have fantasies about young women, okay?
Yeah.
Fantasies are fantasies. It's obviously very different when you kidnap and rape and I mean, you can have all kinds of fantasies. People have violent fantasies.
Yeah.
So that distinction matters because...
But, yes, and the distinction we have today is essentially it's acceptable. And in fact, for movies and television, you know,
movies, you could depict this, and there, you know, it'd be interesting. There may well be a movie about this incident, or a TV movie, maybe, because I think it's, it will get a lot of people will watch it. It's a lurid tale.
But it's also just simply the point, you know, that if you are not screwing the most beautiful creature in the world at any given moment,
which you are, I've met your wife, and she's wonderful.
Let's not go there.
I like Jen very much. That was a compliment to you, Jen.
Let's not go there.
All right, go ahead.
But the point is, you know, then you are inadequate. And unless you've got Viagra and you're 70 years old and are still screwing the most beautiful body in the world, mm-hmm. you are an inadequate human being.
Well, we definitely do that with our you know, the model culture on. I mean, everyone on. Yeah, people seem to be better looking on TV than on the streets. I don't know why that is.
Yeah, and their skin is perfect, you know, and everything. And you know, they love having sex five times a day, and they get to drink as much as they want, and nothing happens. They don't make an ass of themselves.
What lessons can we learn here? I mean, so you're telling us the culture's messed up. I'm basically accepting that to some extent, but also saying we can't ban it. What is to be done?
You have to have an honest conversation.
Okay, well, what is to be done? This is We Act Radio. What should be done?
You have to have an honest conversation about it. The same as about racism or anything else. You have to have an honest conversation. You're going to get people on both extremes who are going to have absurd views. Some people are going to claim it's bad all in terms of religion or whatever. You know, you just simply have to have the conversation and not say that this is not part of who we are. It is part of who we are. How do we counter it? How do we deal with it? How do we shape it? It has to be the same as racism or anything that's out of whack. You've got to have the conversation.
Well, let me make a distinction then in the last minute we have, and that is the distinction between sex and the 1 minute left, yes, between sex and, well, misogyny, mistreatment of women, hatred of women. If a man and a woman are having consensual sex and there's nothing violent involved, and even if they're getting paid for it, I don't really care that much personally.
Never forget that.
You may disagree.
Cuccinelli disagrees.
Well, I'm sure he does. Whether in word or in deed, and words count too, when the woman or man, but when the woman is put down and mistreated and treated like it's not an equal consensual act, that's when I think it crosses the line from something that...
Can I interject one real quick thing?
Real quick, yeah.
Real quick. President Obama, when he was in high school, he was asked by the teacher, what is the most dangerous thing in the world? Most of the students replied, war, death, etc. This ties in with what you were just saying. President Obama, as a high schoolist, said the most dangerous thing in the world is words. Words are the most dangerous thing in the world.
And words can definitely wound. But our words work to heal. So thank you very much, Terry, for coming here on the Raucous Caucus.
Thank you, Mark.
If you want to check out the Raucous Caucus, folks, we are here every Sunday on We Act Radio on AM 1480. Hope you'll tune in at noon every Sunday. Coming up is the Inside Scoop in just a few minutes, and we're going to be focusing more on what happened in Cleveland and this colorful character, Charles Ramsey, but also what has to tell us about race and poverty and abortion and gun control and, yes, our media cultural fixation. So don't miss the Inside Scoop coming up right after this.